introduce me, and for all the things I've done, from Marvel to Call of Duty, from League of Legends to Square Enix stuff, best known as a bean person on the internet, that's what gets the applause. Originally I was going to talk to you guys all about games and education. It's a topic that means a great deal to me, and I'm going to talk about it some here. But it was mentioned to me, how many of you guys went to console, by the way? I'm going to switch back to my games and education. Like, they all seen this one. They don't need this one. We're going to talk about games and education because I want to talk about games and education. Did you guys all see my talk at console?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, great. Then you don't need this. it was mentioned to me, because this is better for students. Hopefully my talk at console got you guys thinking. I would love to dive in a little bit more, especially there were a lot of questions on games and education that that we didn't get to answer, that I would love to go over now. So, back to the same starting point. Yes?
Is this the talk you were going to join again?
Was that a couple of days ago?
No, it was a couple of months ago.
Join was good for
the console. Yeah, this is when I got to start. Join game and never got to actually finish.
Awesome.
So you're actually going to get to hear the end of it. How many of you guys went to join game and saw that talk? Okay, great. We're going to finish that one. Because I'm going to blaze through the beginning of it. You're going to hear some of the same stories. I'm going to talk about the end, and then we can all talk about games education, extra credits, anything you want about games. Or I can crack out a third talk about microtransactions that I'm going to give to Wooga in a few days, which you guys really don't want because it's horribly boring and all about why you shouldn't do microtrans the way we're currently doing microtrans. And if you want to have a conversation, someone should ask me a question about it, and then I will probably pop up some slides, and then I'll just roll into another talk. Alright, so, anyway, I don't even remember what my next slide is because now at this point I forget which talk I'm giving. And my clicker's not working. We're 100% set for this. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right.
Clicker, don't even work. Oh no, you're so sad.
All right. So anyway, as you guys all know, I feel like we have an obligation. By we, but actually me, I have an obligation to harangue you guys all into your generation fixing the problems of the world that we caused. So, the first one is, as creators of games, right, we have this amazingly powerful medium. You've heard me talk about how unbelievably engaging this medium is, how many hours of the year people spend on this medium. I mean, the entire space program took far less time and far less manpower than we put into games as humanity every year. This is an incredible thing, and if we can harness some small portion of that, right, if 1% of the time that you spend playing games, you're learning something, that's an incredibly powerful thing. I think there's a lot of problems with the educational system as it stands now, at least in the US. And after being here for a while, I see some of those same things here. I think that a lot of those problems we can address through what we do. Because at the end of the day, everyone should want to learn, right? The object of school isn't to drill into your head the few basic facts you need. The object of school is to, when you leave those doors, when nobody can threaten you, or with a bad grade, or reward you with some promise of your future career, to have you still wanting to learn. Have you still being interested in finding out more about the world we live in. Because that's something that will carry you through life. And that's something we can provide as game developers. But, so you all seen educational games. I don't have to go over, right? Like, as soon as I said educational games, I saw some people just make this grimace face, right? We all know that a lot of the state of games right now is sort of this flashcards with game skin. We can talk about that more. But really, this is a big trend I've seen in education lately. I have seen so many educators and school boards and school districts say to us, you know what? We really, gamification. We really should use these systems because they're so powerful. And when we talk about gamification, right, we're not talking about adding games to schools. We are talking about badges and trophies and skill trees and leveling and leveling and leveling. Anyway, and some of this is good, right? Badges are visual representation of skills or achievement. Yeah, that's true. And sometimes we need that. All the time, we've been in classes where we don't feel like we're making progress, where we don't understand that actually at the end of this thing, we will be better for it, right? And so we sometimes do need those symbols along the way to tell us. But it's this really weird thing to me. It's completely strange because we have had badges, for a very long time, right? I mean, Boy Scouts have badges. I mean, Napoleon talked about how it's amazing what a man will do for a tiny piece of purple ribbon, right? So we've had this concept for a really long time. And, I mean, points? We've been applying points to things forever. Weight Watchers used this back 40 years ago now. And every time that you fly somewhere, right, you can get a leveling bar, you get to rank up, you get to go gold, platinum, mega platinum, infinite diamond. Right? So they've been using this system. And skill trees, we've had skill trees since before we've had digital games, right? We've had skill trees for back from so old chainmail, right? Even before D&D. So we have to ask ourselves this question about why now? What is it that has gotten us to decide to gamify education today, since we've had all these systems forever? And in some ways, I would like to say that it's that we clearly have recognized the fact that our system is in total collapse and we need to do something. Unfortunately, it's not that optimistic. So, but everybody saw these guys, right? We hear about the things that go on within our community. We hear about World of Warcraft and Call of Duty, and all these things are super huge to us. But they don't get outside of our bubble very much, outside of the gaming community. But these guys were real business, and they made national news everywhere, right? They IPO'd for $10 billion, and they were making money hand over fist, and they were in everyone's consciousness. People who knew nothing about games knew these guys, and knew the games they created. And educators, especially people sort of on the more bureaucratic administrative side of education, saw what they were doing and are like, well, these guys take these leveling bars and some point systems and some more point systems and some timing, and they get people to do boring, repetitive tasks over and over again. And our job as educators is to get people to do boring, repetitive tasks over and over again, so we should use that. There's some clear flaws in that thinking. But it's part of the problem is that, curse you, you have failed me again. All right, I have to walk all the way over here. Part of the problem is that my clicker's not working. Part of the problem is that all of this is based, everything you guys have ever done, based off the research of Burhaus Skinner. This guy, B.F. Skinner, he was a behavioralist. He saw what Pavlov was doing, right? Guy who rung bell, made dogs salivate, saw what he was doing, and was like, pretty cool. I like the fact that you can condition an animal to act against its natural instinct, right? But all you're doing is conditioning instinct. It's like, I can go one further. I can condition acts of volition. So, like any normal sane human being would do, he put pigeons in boxes. And so he's putting these pigeons in boxes, and he's giving them a button. And on the side of this box, you press this button, and they get a food color. And then they press again, and they get a food color. Then he starts changing up how often they get a food pellet when they press this button. And eventually, there's no food pellets coming out, and these pigeons are just pressing and pressing and pressing and pressing this button. And that's an amazing thing, right? Because pressing a button is not an instinct. That's something that we think of as a choice, as an act of volition. And yet here you can get people to get this pigeon to act against its natural, do something that's a totally meaningless act, but you can condition them to do it. And you know what? Any one of these you've ever seen is based off his research. Exact same research. Slot machines, the entire industry. In fact, Burhaus Skinner made the majority of his money consulting for the slot machine industry. So, clearly, we have this conflict, right? Because kids ain't pigeons, schools ain't slots. So, we really gotta rethink. So what we're looking to do is engage kids in education, not addict them to it. I, as a designer, and so many other designers in the room will tell you, yeah, of course, I actually, no problem. I can create a system for you that'll get a kid to do his math problems over and over and over and over again. I can't get him to get anything from it. There's plenty of research out there that shows, and I mean, even as some of the Zynga research, they would go out and ask people to describe their experience with Farmville. Tell me about your last play session. People couldn't really remember it, right? They knew they did it, but what did they do during it? Planted some stuff. And they'd ask them, well, at least, did you enjoy it? And they mention it. Not really. I don't know why I'm still playing. And some of you guys have had the same experience with like World of Warcraft or other things of this nature that use a lot of Skinner's research. But our goal can't be to simply addict kids to doing these things. We gotta get them, right? And really, this idea of extrinsic reward makes no sense in school. Extrinsic reward is taking something outside the experience you're having and motivating you through that, right? I will pay you some money to go do this thing. I will give you some points if you successfully complete this task, because the task itself isn't something you want to do. But that can't be the case in education. We can't have an educational system where the only reason you're there is because someone has told you you get something that has nothing to do with educating yourself for doing this thing that otherwise we never wanted to. The truth is, there's tons of research. I mean, there's been study after study after study after study showing that anybody whose kids who are given an extrinsic reward to do an activity, to learn something, are less likely to engage in activity themselves after that reward is taken away. We can't keep people in schools forever. In fact, more than that, more than ever, we need you to go on your own free time and engage with some of these things. And so the system can't just be this gamification that piles points, rewards behind things. And so instead, we need to start talking about, and this is one thing that I need all of you to start communicating, right? Because you get it, and you can talk to teachers, you can talk to parents, people who may not be within the sphere of our gaming world. We gotta start using these principles of play. We gotta start using the things that we've learned from spending billions and billions of dollars on making games for something other than a way to pass the time. And it's tragic that we don't, right? I mean, you've all seen this before, but never see a game where you start with 1,000,000 points and you just lose points and lose points and lose points and lose points and oh. And yet, that is actually most of our experience in school, right? You go work and you work and you work and you eventually, you come in on the first day and you think of yourself as sort of having an A, right? Maybe subconscious and maybe you don't really accurately think about it. But that's right. And then you watch yourself fall further and further behind until you just naturally gravitate to a level you desperately tread water to maintain. That is the experience of school. And we've learned in games, right, that people, and you don't even need games for this, but we've learned in games, people are vastly more motivated by watching themselves make progress than they are by watching themselves fall further and further behind. And this is the one place that we can take stuff from gamification, right? This is the one thing that this is how we make badges and that sort of thing meaningful. But the simple answer is start grading up instead of down. There's absolutely no reason. It doesn't change what I do under the hood as a teacher. It doesn't change how I grade anything to start grading you up from 0 towards an eventual score than grading you from your A, working your way down. And it also opens up whole other possibilities we can talk about, such as not making schooling strictly year-based, but rather achievement-based, but that's a completely other discussion. Really what I want to get to is pop culture. So any film you've seen, right, whether it's something like Star Wars, something like The Godfather, any piece of pop music you've ever seen, ever listened to, uses the same sort of dynamics, the same sort of general way to engage you. And it's this, right? Many of you have seen this before, but somebody, what's right here on this chart? Can you all read this chart? This is Star Wars. So this is the engagement curve that almost all good pop art uses. We've learned over time that that human beings, to actually follow something, you don't want to be maximum engaging all the time. And I hear teachers, when I talk to them about games, they tell me, oh, I asked them how engaging are games, and I'm like, oh, they're up here all the time. But that's not true, right? It's like eating Snickers. You want to eat like candy after candy. The first one's great. After 20, you're a little sick. So we need some variation. And so we've learned sort of what it is, how we go about. We have a system for engaging human beings that we can use in the classroom. But back to the question. So what's right here? Yes.
Droids wandering the desert.
It's moisture farming.
Yes.
Right? So you got this big sequence where we got rebels fighting, a princess being captured, we got this Star Destroyer flying in, and then we have to land moisture farming because we need that. As human beings, to set up the rest of it, we need that. And by establishing this pattern, he's allowed to do a lot of the exposition, setup of the story, all that that he needs within this lull. And what's amazing about that is it's perfect for teaching. In teaching, we need, because we have these points where we're not going to be able to give you as just amazingly engaging information. If any of you guys have watched Extra History, we try and build an extra history around this chart. And so as we're building out our lesson plans, we simply need to start thinking beyond simply what we have to teach, but how we can teach it to engage. Because we have these systems, we know these are proven and tested methods. But going even beyond that, you hear athletes and musicians, painters, you know, all these people talk about being in the zone, right? And many of you guys have probably experienced it, especially in games, that state where you're just laser focused and you're achieving at your highest possible level and you're breaking barriers and making to new plateaus and doing things you've never done before. And this is actually pretty simple. We build it into games all the time. It's this idea called flow. There's a great book by a guy named Csikszentmihalyi, which I can't possibly spell because he's Polish and I don't even know what the name of the characters over his letters are. But go look at flow, you'll find it. Flow is this concept that if we sort of modulate, if we match the difficulty of the challenges you're presented with your level of skill, so you're at your maximum level of skill but continuously achieving, you're not failing at your maximum level of skill. You'll sort of enter the state where where you become totally absorbed in the activity. And there's lots of different ways to do this, and some of them can be very routine. But in games, we have to develop this all the time. When you've had this moment in your top-down shooter, in your bullet hell, where the screen sort of glazes over and you're not even watching, or in Guitar Hero, where you don't have to watch anymore, right? You were just doing it at this incredibly high level. And then when you're done with that experience, you have a realization, you understand what you did, and now you're better at it, right? You know, you can look back and you've just reached a new plateau, you've broken those barriers. And in school, right, open any math textbook, what do you see? You see just a bunch of problems. Those problems are just laid out in any haphazard order that you might find them. It's no good, right? Simply by reordering the problems in front of us, thank you. You mean you didn't like the irritating buzz? That was part of my talk, man. So, anyway, getting back on topic. When you look at a math textbook, nobody is ever hitting this flow state. I don't think we can do it for everybody, but simply by reordering the problems in that math book, we can get a lot closer, right? We can start graduating you up this channel. We can get some people who say, while studying, I was just there, right? I was in the zone. Right, it sounds hilarious. But we can do that. We can deliver on that. We've had practice of that as game designers, as developers. So next we have to talk about real engagement, right? If we're gonna move past this idea of extrinsic rewards, if we're gonna move past this idea of having something outside of the classroom be the only reason that you stay in the classroom, we have to talk about, okay, so what is it that keeps you there? And to me, I feel like we spend a little too much time, and we have to, right? As teachers, it's very difficult. We don't have enough hours in the day. We spend too much time trying to make kids learn things and too little thinking about why they might actually want to learn them. I think this is the first step, right? I think this is the first thing that we have to communicate clearly. And so, while I was working for Pearson, who you probably don't know here, but it's a textbook big textbook maker in the US, they make the SATs, and they asked me, can you make some games for us? We have a couple of target things, games hip with the kids, we want to be in that market, make some games for us. And there was one that I built that couldn't scale. So, I can actually talk to you about it because it's not NDA. But this one, they'd asked me, we have a number of young women who are not doing well in the STEM subjects, the maths and sciences, and we want to get them more involved in these core math, science, technology fields. And the problem was, that for some reason, I don't know how it is here, but our culture has all these innate biases that tell young women that they shouldn't be good at these things, which is utterly ludicrous. And so they asked me to go in. And I sat down with these young women. And the first thing I had to do was take away these biases. So I started talking to them. And I come in, holding this big old box of beads, and I set it down on the table, and tell them the story. Tell them the story about this tribe. And in this tribe, they would make ritual necklaces. When you were a young woman, when you reached a certain age, you would make yourself a necklace. And every year, you would add a bead to that necklace. And then I would ask them, hey, go make this necklace. Go make the necklace for your age. And they'd all go and do it. And I would tell them, and when you reach a certain age, you get some new rules, new ways to add these beads. And then I would try, oh, you guys are real smart, right? Let's go make me for this age. Make me for this age. Try one now that's over that age limit, and they would do it. And what was amazing is I would watch them help each other, right? When somebody was doing it wrong, they would turn to the other one and go, hey, no, it's actually kind of like this, right? The pattern's this way. And they would work together, and they would all want to do this. And then, after they've been doing this for half hour, 45 minutes, tell them the truth. It's electron shells. All the rules for electron shells. For 8 to 12 year olds, I was teaching them stuff that you don't learn until the second year of college. Because I had size, shape, color, I had all these things to work with. We could even get suborbitals, right? It was fantastic. And I would show them this, and once they had that, and I told them it was the same rules, then I would tell them, give me iron, right? Give me element 63. And they would do it. And because they had learned in a context that they were not afraid of, in a context that they were inherently engaged in, which was something that they had already wanted to do, they had no problem. They would blaze through it, and they were enjoying themselves, and they were enjoying themselves with science. And that's something that we can bring. But at the end of this, I sat back, and I talked to them. I took 5 minutes at the end to say, hey, and you know what we've got here? We've got the beads, we've got the building blocks of everything, from a leaf on the wind, to us, to the universe itself, right? And that all the most beautiful things can be found, made up of this right here. And I get mail to this day from teachers who are still in contact with some of the students about the fact that some of them have gone on to careers in science fields, in mathematical fields, because the fear was taken away, and then they understood why. They understood why this might actually matter to them, why it might give them something that they want in their life, and then they could run with it. So that's what I want to see us do. But before I go, there's one other thing I want to talk about, and it's sort of some of these problems that we can solve with modern education with games. And many of you guys have probably seen some of this on extra credits, but I just want to throw it at you as a refresher, because I think these are important. When we have these dialogues with people outside of the games world, you need the ammunition, right? Sure, games are engaging, games are fun. That's not enough. We know that's not enough. And often, that will marginalize us, that will relegate us to a children's pastime. So what else do they do? First off, they allow us to give a solutions-focused education rather than a retention-focused one. In the past, when our education system was first developed, well, it was developed in Prussia in the 1850s. It was developed to take an agrarian society to become an industrial one, right? And at that time, you better have learned everything in school and have it memorized in your head. Because otherwise, you go back to your village, and you go and you become a shopkeeper. Well, if you don't have those multiplication tables memorized, there's no place to look them up. But that's not our world today, right? Our world today, we all have so much more data in the palms of our hands, right? On the internet, with Wikipedia, all these things, that we don't need to be memorizing data. We don't need to be inculcating facts to people. What we need to do is get them to use the data that they have in front of them to come to solutions. And I can think of nothing. I mean, this is something we do all the time. This is what games are about, right? Games give you a set of data and then say, here's some problems. Figure out the best way to solve these problems with the data that you have in front of you, the information you have. And that's a powerful thing, right? That teaches us, that moves us away from simply memorizing to really applying all these things we're supposed to learn. Next, this idea of iterative learning. Very often, and you've all had this, you get homework, and a week later, get back with a grade on it. And I would love to say, and you would all love to say, and you'd love to tell me, oh yeah, of course, I always look carefully over the homework that I get back with that grade, I see what I did, and I'm not going to do that wrong again. Right, I see all those faces. And the truth is, of course not. I mean, you shove it in your bag because that was a week ago, and you have no idea what you had even done on that paper, and you're on to new things and you've got other homework and you can't even correct this and get a better grade. Because hey, your teachers actually can't, they don't have the time and it's not their fault to allow you to regrade and regrade and regrade everything. But let's instead talk about what that does. First off, that creates a fear of failure. We don't live in a world where you have to get everything right on the first try. In fact, as human beings, we learn. We learn by falling down, right? We learn by failing, getting up, trying something different, and seeing if it works. And in this case, all your tests, all this homework, all it's doing is telling you, you better get it right on the first time, or you're going to get a bad grade, and mom and dad's going to be angry. And it keeps us from just boldly trying things and embracing that failure and learning from that failure. Because today, in this world, what you actually want to do, most companies, most jobs you'll ever have, don't need you to get everything right on the first try. They want you to come to the best answer the fastest. That's what they're looking for. And that's not something that our current system gives you. We also waste so much time with homework as an assessment. Right now, often, how homework works, especially in high school, is that as a teacher, I'll lecture at you, right? And I send you home with the homework, and all the homework does is check if you actually learned, if you know what was said in that lecture. It doesn't teach you anything. It just assesses whether or not you successfully got that in your brain. But that's like 4+ hours a night that we are not teaching you. If I'm going to make you sit and do this stuff, well, we don't have time. Today, in this world, think about how much more there is that you have to learn than there was back in the 1850s. I, as a teacher, need every single hour I can possibly get of you learning. And so as such, homework can't just be an assessment. Homework has to be a time to learn. And this is what we get out of having an iterative method, right? You see, I work with kids playing games all the time. I watch these kids, and even young kids, right? They run to a room, try and gun everything down, get killed, spawn outside the room. They run back in, they'll see some cover. They'll duck behind that cover. And then every room thereafter, without telling them, without doing anything, they realize and they go straight for that cover. This is how we actually learn, right? And games can provide us that. Games can provide us that immediate feedback. That kid who's running into that room, he got feedback, but that was the wrong answer instantaneously. He didn't have to wait for a week trying to remember what it is or what he shot at to get another life, to get another chance. Instead, he got it immediately and said, okay, that was wrong, try something again. And he kept continuing to try things and getting feedback on whether or not it was right until he got to the right answer. And then he got to assess why that was right and then apply that again and again and again. That's something that games give us that the modern homework system doesn't. That's another reason that we should bring games into education. But there's even more, right? As a teacher, no matter how small my classroom is, I can't build a lesson for every one of you. I would love to be able to tailor my lessons to make sure that everybody's keeping up, that everybody's getting the information the way they need to get that information. But it can't be done. But in a game, we do all this stuff, right? We have all different ways. I can pop up contextual menus. I can tell things. I can give you a hint, right? You're playing a game about your algebra and you're not doing well. Well, as a game, I can take metrics. I can know that. I can try and, okay, let's make it a little bit easier. Still not working? Let's try and introduce you to, let's give you a different tutorial, right? Let's set you up with some other learning method. Maybe that first one, maybe just giving you text boxes wasn't enough. Maybe we should let you emulate a character, another character doing it. Maybe we should try all these other things. Maybe periodically, if I see you doing one small thing wrong, I can just pop up a reminder on the screen. And so at the end of the day, we can tailor the lesson specifically around how you're playing. And especially, at the end of that, I can have it send an email to the teacher. And I would love, as a teacher, a mail saying, hey, Johnny was playing the algebra game, and here's what we tried. We tried this, 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 and this. None of it was really working. Maybe you should sit down and have a one-on-one session. And this is something that we have to explain as well, right? Games will never replace teachers. Teachers are an integral part of the classroom. Games are a tool. Very often I see teachers concerned that we're just going to sit down and have kids play games. Games are a jumping off point. Games are a place to start, but they never will allow us that breadth of knowledge, that individual interaction. But we can buy teachers more time and better tools to have that individual interaction through games. And lastly, I want to go over 21st century skills. Some of you may have heard me talk about this as well, right? But critical thinking, communication, collaboration, creativity. U.S. government went out and spent massive amounts of money doing a huge survey of all these colleges, of all these big top 200 companies, and said, hey, what do you need from our students to be effective citizens? What do you need? They got these four things as an answer. I can't think of anything. I mean, these are exactly what we do in games all the time. COD match? I mean, assuming you can actually, you're certainly practicing your communication. Sometimes, but I mean, or teamwork, right? League of Legends. As much as it may feel like an individual skill game, right? The team that wins is always the team that coordinates better, like 100% of the time. You can take a much worse individual skill team, and they will crush a team that is totally uncoordinated, every man for themselves. And so you see people practicing their teamwork skills all the time in a game like this. Creativity. Our current system doesn't believe that you can teach creativity, that you can get better at creativity. And yet, we have a system for practicing it, right? You see kids in Minecraft every day building things, becoming more creative. And I run into people even here who, when put a blank page put in front of them, they don't know where to start. And yet, freeing you to do that, allowing you to have practice doing that expression, is something that we can deliver in games. We can actually sort of train and present you a place in which you can be creative in a way that we haven't been able to before in education. And of course, critical thinking, I mean, that's all most games are, right? There's so many games that are just about our logical operations. There's also a lot of games about lateral thinking, about being outside the box, about finding solutions that are beyond what we'd expect. These are the things we need. These are the things we need to be citizens in a 21st century world. We have those tools. There's no reason that we should not bring them in to the place that we're preparing people to be citizens in the 21st century world. Beyond that, just one more thing. Sometimes it's the smallest thing. And I repeat this story a lot because it meant a lot to me. And I think it's one of the most powerful, it was a realization about one of the most powerful things that games do. I was working at a lower income school. I was working at a school where I didn't go to college, or pregnancy or something like that. Just happened where there was a kid who told me he couldn't do his homework because he was hiding in the bathtub because there were gunshots outside that night. It's a tragic place, but they asked me to come in, one of the teachers, just periodically and play some games with the kids and talk to them about games. And we're playing Super Mario, and there's this one kid, and I was going to talk to him about iteration and all that stuff, and he runs and jumps and falls in the pit. Runs and jumps, falls in the pit. Runs and jumps and tries something different. And he gets over the pit. And in that moment, the door opened a little bit for us to have this conversation. It wasn't his life changing his life, but all of a sudden we could talk about that was his life, right? College may be really difficult to get to, but it wasn't pre-written, right? He didn't have some specific fate. Because of where he was born, because of what he was born into, he didn't have it all laid out for him. He wasn't doomed to this one specific thing. Instead, in a game, he could see that compression of time. He could see choice and consequence in a way that he couldn't actually see in his own life. He could see that, yeah, he was free to think about the future. He was free to think past this moment and think about what this moment might affect. And that's a powerful thing. If schools are meant to do anything, right, they're to empower us, to give us a sense of agency, to allow us to understand we can do whatever we want with this life. And that's what games do as well. Bringing the two together will help us deliver on one of the most important aspects of your school. Because when you're out here, when there's no one telling you to do these assignments, you in the end have got to choose for yourself what it is that you want to not just follow a life written for you, but take all these things that you've gotten here and make the life you want. So with that, we'll leave off because that's enough of my talking. I want to hear all your thoughts. I want to hear any questions you may have for me, and they can be about anything. I like to rant about games and education a lot. A lot of you guys, many of you have seen this in different parts, in three different ways now. Four, if you count extra credits. It's a topic that matters a great deal. And I'm happy to talk about it for as long as we want. But I also want to make sure that this is as useful to all of you as students, as people who are about to enter the games industry. So if there's any thoughts or questions, I have now been speaking about thoughts or questions for a long time. So good, I'm in a classroom in Norway where there's a question as soon as I'm done. That is fantastic. All right, shoot.
Your best moment from teaching ever.
Ooh, that's a tough one. That one is actually pretty close. This is a totally different one. This is a completely different vector. I wasn't actually teaching. It was this year. I was at PAX. And I never get any time at PAX at all. I don't get to go to the show floor, any of this stuff. So I finally, on the last day, I walk into the top floor of PAX. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen, but it's like five stories tall of just games and games and games. And I walk into the top floor, and I look around, and like half of the booths there are former students of mine. They're companies founded by these former students of mine. I could walk around running into my students, each of them manning their booth, right, presenting this thing, and it's been great. Like, I'm sitting there chatting with one of them, and journalists will come up and talk to them about their game, and all that stuff. And so it was one of these moments where sometimes, like everything, it's hard in the moment to see that you're having an effect, that what you're doing matters. And it's little things like that that remind you and allow you during the hardest moments to remember that it matters. So that'll be my answer for that. Other thoughts or questions? Oh, over there, shoot.
You talked about gamification and how using external rewards might not be the best way to get somebody to learn a subject.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if you thought about using gamification on a social aspect in the classroom, if there's a lot of negative social stuff going on in the classroom, using like experience points levels to actually improve the social aspect of the classroom.
So, in some ways, it might be hyperbolic. There are certain classrooms where using a gamified system to force behavior in a different direction may have value. I would rather see something like a game in which you've got a party, and that party, like any other party, get your wizard and your warrior and all this stuff. But it requires somebody with math skills, and somebody with history skills, and somebody who knows a lot of literature, and the guy who can lift big things or run real fast, right? So everybody starts understanding, they have to work together, and they start understanding the value of each other's skills. I think that it's not the worst to use gamification. In fact, it might be positive in some ways to use gamification, but I think that as game creators, we have the option to create experiences which deliver that in a more meaningful way, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Have you heard about John Hunter and the World Peace game?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because I think that's, what he does there is something you talk about.
Love things like that.
Yeah.
So, to let you all know, have any of you guys played Democracy 3 or 4? Ish? No. You guys know, the UI is terrible. It's like this big blob of dots. But anyway, you should check out Democracy. I often teach a class where it's a great tool, and this is why I think that teachers are such an important part of it. It's a great tool because it's a scheme that's all about sort of setting policy. Instead of being able to do what you do in most games, being the god emperor who can just by fiat command whatever you want, like in Civ, you sort of have to. You have all these interlocking policy choices and a population which is going to vote your party in and out of power, all this stuff. And I do it with a class like this, and every choice, every decision, every problem that they're trying to solve within the society, I have them vote. And I make some of them ministers, and I give them specific agendas that they have that they keep secret from the rest of the class. And then everybody has to work together and coordinate, and it's this experience that, like with the World Peace Game, right, those are the experiences that really get people brought together. And I think that's a powerful thing. So I love the fact that you're referencing the World Peace Game. Other thoughts or questions? Yes?
You're given an infinite amount of money, but you can only change one thing with the American school system. What would that be?
With an infinite amount of money. Giving Americans an infinite amount of money is the worst idea. The problem is that there's all these interlocking pieces. I mean, the easiest answer is obviously I would make sure that every child has more than plenty to live a decent life while also ensuring that it's doled out in such a manner that they can't just blow it all right away, right? But truth is, if I had one thing to do, okay, this is going to be more than one thing sorted, but I'm going to try and cram it down all in one thing. I think we have to start with teachers. I think we have to give teachers better education. We have to make sure that educating teachers is free. We have to give them better salaries. We have to give them more room to experiment, right? And we have to allow more of these experimental classroom spaces and give them the tools, the metrics to really see whether or not they're succeeding. As much as I would like to say I would start with students in some ways, I think that we have to empower teachers and we have to make sure we have the best teachers. And teachers who are willing to, as we enter this new phase, as we have to reinvent schooling, we're willing to be part of that process. Other thoughts? Questions? Yes, again, let's go.
Have you heard about, in Bergen, teacher used the Walking Dead?
I have worked with that fellow and he's great.
Awesome. Do you have any other concrete examples or sort of success stories about teachers using a specific game in a teaching environment?
Well, I have a couple of my own. At that same school, there's a guy who uses Civ as a jumping off point for history. I have met, there's a fellow, I mean, you guys may know, the Minecraft professor, who teaches a lot of things to, especially younger people, but through Minecraft, and also teaches the basic programming logic through Redstone, right? There's a YouTube channel with a guy from NASA who plays Kerbal Space Program. And then he talks about the physics, right? Teaches about, and I've seen lots of people at least become far more engaged in aerospace physics than they might otherwise be through this idea, right? Of, hey, here's this game, but let me tell you how it's more than a game, right? Let me tell you how it's analog to real life. Let me tell you how this thing that's cool is, I mean, it's actually really cool in real life, too. And so, yeah, there are more. I'm sure you could dig up some more, but people are really doing it. And it is successful. The problem is we don't have data. Like all these examples, if you guys know any sociologists or anybody who's studying sociology, go have them help you take some data as you start building out these sort of games, as you start playing the games in the classroom. Because one of the biggest impediments in the US, at least, is that there's no good data to say, I mean, I believe this to be true. I absolutely believe it. But we need to know. And the government, before they're willing to really let us implement it on a mass scale, needs to know. So that would be my only other thing, is I really need some data. But other thoughts or questions? Yes?
I guess a bit off topic. But
no, shoot.
You mentioned that we should, there might be an idea to grade upwards instead of downwards. Mm-hmm. But here in Norway, the school system has done that for years, high school and lower.
Okay.
Starting with 1 and up to 6, basically the same as A to F, but just 6 is top and 1 is bottom. It's not really any different except that 3, which would equal D, is considered the middle.
So, a couple of questions about that. Do you start at 0 and then after you take your first test or whatever, are you at like 0.25?
It's...
Do you actually build up?
No.
Right, okay, then it's fundamentally different. I still like it better, but what it is really building up is the important part of that system, not just doing it numerically, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Yes, back there.
Which game that you have worked on is your favorite?
It's really tough.
Choose between all your babies now.
Personal favorite? Like, that I would want to play or most interesting to work on?
Both.
Play and work on. Like, one of each.
Alright, so to play, it might be Magic. I really like to draft. I will confess this. Work on it. God, there have been so many interesting problems. Stuff I can't really talk about some of the things that Zynga was wrestling actually with were some of the most interesting problems I had ever seen. I don't necessarily think they addressed them in the correct manner, but the problems themselves were fascinating. So I'm going to go with that. Other questions or thoughts? Anything you want to ask? Yeah.
Just favorite game overall to play.
If you have a favorite game, you have not played enough games. I can maybe give you like favorite by genre, but not even that changes by day. Really, it's like asking me favorite band, right? I actually can't do it. If you asked me 6 seconds from now, I would have a completely different answer. I can tell you right now, the two that I've been playing a lot, well, the three that I've been playing a lot are Dark Souls 2, Endless Legend, and This War of Mine. And those are the ones that most of the time, right? So, okay, I book into my schedule every day, 15 minutes a day, to play a game I've never played before. On the weekends, I will try and carve out 2 hours to really dig into the mechanics of some of the more interesting of these games. Those are the three games that I've put in more than that amount of time. Because unfortunately, as you enter this industry, you will find that you absolutely still need to play games, no question. And you better still enjoy playing games. But you won't have time to play games to the same degree that you do now. And just to keep abreast of everything, to keep aware of everything that's out in the market that comes out today, is a monumental task. But I saw another hand somewhere. Oh, perfect, let's go.
Are you working with anyone to gather data about the judicial race?
A little bit, where I can. It's not, I am barely able to juggle my life at this point. And I wish I could do more. We just released a video on changing the rating system. And somebody was like, oh, you should totally work to do this. I'm like, I would love to. I would absolutely love to. Give me 6 more lifetimes. Thank you all. All right, other questions? Any thoughts? Anything else? Or should we just move to the... Oh yeah, we got one back there, sure.
You mentioned Kerbal Space Program and games that have a... They don't do it as an agenda, but they have a happy side effect of educating people. Of your games, which is the one you felt had the most unintentional impact sort of on another thing than just being a fun game?
That's a really good question. Again, of things I've worked on, right? Because I consult. So years ago, I decided I wanted to see more projects. And unlike you youngins today, it's at a time where you didn't have Unity and you couldn't just throw anything up on Steam. And we didn't have iPhones and Facebook. And so the only way for me to not spend 3 years on a project was to see less of these things. So I don't count any of these as my games. Like, just know that all games are this big multidisciplinary thing, unless you are. You're that solo guy, do it yourself. Actually, I think Magic, but that's cheating because it's really Richard's thing, right? Richard, from the outset, designed it in some ways to be educational. And I think there's a lot of things that get you to practice that are very positive, that are totally, that don't necessarily appear on the surface to the player, right? They don't have you over the head with it. But any other thoughts or questions? Yeah, shoot.
What do you think is most effective for learning games that teachers have without you actually knowing, or games that are made for teaching and things?
So, there's a couple aspects to this. First off, the way that we currently do games that teach you things is awful. So, games that are intended to teach you things right now are usually delivered by people who are very well-meaning, but who know a lot, who are subject matter experts. They know a lot about what they're trying to teach, but don't really know a lot about engagement. And it's because the games industry doesn't talk to anyone who's trying to build games to educate. Like, this is one of the things that you guys can solve. You can reach out to these people. And so right now, this whole flashcards with the game skin, I mean, the reason that everybody like groaned or gave me a face when I started talking about games education is because of how poorly done games meant to educate generally are. That said, think now local, it used to be French, things like Dragon Box, right? Dragon Box could be a lot better in terms of engagement. Like, everybody here can see how to make a better Dragon Box. That's a real fundamental rethinking that's meant to teach, but it reveals that to you eventually, right? It takes you from this path from pure game to, oh wait, that whole time I was learning. And I think that's a good approach. I also think that we don't have to divorce the two entirely. I think that both have an incredible place. I think that things like Civilization that just get people recognizing and interested in these leaders and these technology and this, the way that human civilization evolved, I think that's an amazing thing. At the same time, things like Counting Kingdoms, which is strictly about doing math problems, but is about doing them in a way that's engaging. You've all heard me rail about Counting. I'm going to assume you've all heard that. Good. I think they all have their place. Different tools for different things. The only thing I would say we need to avoid is that game that is education, not first, but solely, right? That is a game wrapper around a piece of textbook. Because, I mean, most of you guys know, there are all these times where you sit down and somebody tries to give you a game for education, you'd literally rather read the textbook. And that's totally backwards, right? But yeah, other questions or thoughts? Good. Oh, hey, there we go.
Excitement about the new upcoming games.
Oh, that's a good question. Oh boy. So I was really excited. So a lot of the ones I've been super excited about actually came out recently. Grimrock 2, I was super excited about. This War of Mine, I was super excited about. Beyond Earth, I was super excited about. And so those were all fantastic. I'm trying to think of things that I have worked on enough MOBAs at this point, and I'm very curious to see how Heroes of the Storm does. What else am I really excited about in the near future? Oh, actually, one of the things I'm most excited about is the upcoming Kentucky Route Zero episodes. I want to see the end of Kentucky Route Zero. I'm a big fan of that game. But yeah, anything else? Any other questions? I think I'm running out. Oh, there we go.
The indie game you're funding. How's that going?
So, we were every. Okay, let me put it this way. Fundamentally, they're going to have to raise more money to do it. They've been spending so much, but they've been working all this time on the small pittance we gave them, like after tax, after the cut that Rocket Hunt kept. Like, I mean, we gave them, what, like $35,000 or something? And they've been working all this time, and I keep asking, are you guys going to die? And they're like, no, let's work on our game. We're not showing it until it's ready. And we promised that we wouldn't push developers to kick their games out the door. And I need to, for the next game, I'm going to modulate that promise somewhat. But I'm trying to stick to it, and I'm trying not to violate the numbers to talk about the game. They were originally going to, they've got a pretty solid demo together. They've got most of the stuff together. They were going to go do their Kickstarter either this month or next month, but it just got pushed back to February because there's a bunch of statistics on Kickstarter, and they convinced themselves that it's far worse to kickstart during this period, which is actually probably true. But it kills me. Like, no one wants that game released more than I do. Just so that way I don't have to answer that question. But no one wants that game released more than I do. I will also be frank with you. The game that we originally funded was something I thought was worth a gamble. They had a really good idea, a really interesting idea. The demo for it was really solid. About 8 months into development, they realized that they couldn't do it, right? It was a much bigger project. They wanted to do it as Project 2, maybe Project 3, but it was not of a scope that was feasible. And so they've switched this other project. And the other project is good. It's not exceptional. I mean, it's doing something different. It's interesting. I'm still glad we're doing it. I want to see the first project that we fund eventually, right? Like, this one's good, but it's not great, right? It's not radically. It's not something that I think is going to start a new genre. Get people to think about mechanics differently, or get people to have an experience. We'll get people to have an experience they never had before. So that's good. I don't mean to complain. It's something that I would love to see come out. I think it will come out. I just don't want to come out 4 years after they start because it's a ridiculous amount of time to take to make that game. It's a ridiculous amount of time to make everybody wait. And yeah, I'm trying to not break that promise of saying, hey, let's see what a developer does when you give them time to actually get their thing right. Because I agree with your earlier statement, right? I have never launched a game that is as good as I know it could be, right? Ever, period, it will never be done. Because as you build your game, you always realize more cool things that you could do, more things that you could fix, the ways your game will be better. And at some point, you gotta ship. I'm trying this experiment by letting people not have to ship. And all I think what it's principally taught me is that, no, sometime you have to ship. But all right, does it seem good to wrap up so we can do the group QA? Okay, let's do it.